Well, we are moving on in our series, Divine Destiny, which has been kind of our build-up to Easter. As many of you know, we started in the book of John back in 2019, and we're kind of coming to a close on the book of John. We've timed this so that next Sunday we get to the passage in John where Jesus is resurrected. Makes sense, right? But what that means is that there is no... Oh, first of all, I'd like to thank John Knack for speaking for me last week. We were on vacation. Where's Pastor John? Thank you, sir. I appreciate that. John spoke on the crucifixion today. We're going to talk about the burial. And what that means is we're not going to have a Palm Sunday sermon, which is kind of weird. It's the first time, as your pastor, that on Palm Sunday I didn't speak on the triumphal entry of Jesus into Jerusalem, which is kind of strange. As a matter of fact, my mother-in-law and my in-laws were at the house yesterday. We were eating dinner and playing Rook, good old church people game. And we mentioned that there's no Palm Sunday sermon, and my mother-in-law was like stunned, like, what? I mean, aren't we going to wave palm branches? And we had a reminder that, hey, we're moving through the book of John. So, as a matter of fact, when we went, we did look at the triumphal entry in the book of John, and if you're looking for that, it's back in, listen to this, September 20th of 2020. That's how long, I mean, we've been doing other series. That's how long we've been in the last half of the book of John. Now, one of the classic things you get in a Palm Sunday sermon is the contrast between the two crowds. Whether or not it was one crowd that changed their mind or two different crowds, there's that contrast of the crowd that says, crown him, make him king, and the crowd that says, crucify him and give us Barabbas. That's the contrast we get in almost every Palm Sunday sermon. Now, we don't have that contrast, but we do have another contrast. And that's the response to Jesus' crucifixion. Namely, and really, we're going to focus on the response of the disciples, because quite honestly, in the text we're going to look at, there is no response of the disciples. We don't see them. We hear about them in a little bit. But here are the disciples. We're going to see that they're nowhere to be found. They've run away. They're in hiding, as John 20 will eventually tell us. They're in hiding. And I wonder what they must be thinking. For 3 years, they've been following Jesus. They've been watching him raise the widow's son. They've been watching him feed the masses. And here we are. He's dead. I mean, there was that moment where Peter says, you are the Christ, the Messiah. What an incredible time. And then Jesus is dead, like really dead, arrested, crucified, and they're nowhere to be found. I can't imagine what's going through their mind. Fear and anger, denial, certainly disappointment, perhaps hopelessness. I bet you they had a lot of questions and maybe some doubts. What has the last 3 years of my life even meant? Now, I want to be clear. I'm not here to judge the disciples. I'm not here to say, well, look, they did it wrong, because I would do it wrong myself. I'm in no position to cast blame on them, because I do the same things I think we all do when we face what the disciples were facing. That was like the darkest moment of their life. When we face dark moments, not even the darkest moment, don't we do the same thing? Fear and anger, denial, disappointment, hopelessness, questions and doubts. Whether that is an unexpected loss financially, or maybe that's some sort of slow, simmering marital tension, still a dark moment. Or maybe it's a sudden loss of a loved one, or maybe your friends turn their back on you in the halls of your school. The good news is that today's passage, I believe, will offer us hope in those times when we find ourselves in the dark moments of life. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to John chapter 19. As you do, let me give you a little background, and I know you've probably heard this before, but John was written in the last part of the first century, decades after the church had been in existence, decades after Matthew, Mark, and Luke were written. So he gives us kind of a different perspective and a different emphasis, and he says, hey, my purpose in writing, we'll see this in John chapter 20. It's funny, we've this far into John, we haven't heard it yet. My purpose in writing this is that you would believe and you would have life in him. Let's read John chapter 19, verses 31 through 42. It was a day of preparation, and the Jewish leaders didn't want the bodies hanging there the next day, which was the Sabbath, and a very special Sabbath because it was the Passover week. So they asked Pilate to hasten their deaths by ordering that their legs be broken. Then their bodies could be taken down. So the soldiers came and broke the legs of the two crucified men with Jesus. But when they came to Jesus, they saw that he was already dead, so he didn't break his legs. One of the soldiers, however, pierced his side with a spear, and immediately blood and water flowed out. This report is from an eyewitness giving an accurate account. He speaks the truth so that you also may continue to believe. These things happen in fulfillment of scriptures that say, no one of his bones will be broken. They will look at the one they pierced. Afterwards, Joseph of Arimathea, who had been a secret disciple of Jesus, because he feared the Jewish leaders, asked Pilate for permission to take down Jesus' body. When Pilate gave permission, Joseph came and took the body away. With him came Nicodemus, the man who had come to Jesus at night. He brought about 75 pounds of perfumed ointment made from myrrh and aloe. Following Jewish burial custom, they wrapped Jesus' body in spices in long sheets of linen cloth. The place of crucifixion was near the garden, where there was a new tomb never used before. And so because it was the day of preparation for the Jewish Passover, and since the tomb was close at hand, they laid Jesus there. Now, you're like, wait a minute, didn't you say we're going to compare the disciples' response to the crucifixion? There is no disciple. We don't see anything in here about disciple. There is at least one disciple. We'll get there. Let's just walk through this passage really quick, and we'll hone in on one particular thing. First of all, it was the day of preparation. The very first part of verse 31, it was the day of preparation because it was a special Sabbath, was the next day, because it was the Sabbath during the Passover week. The religious leaders did not want on this high and holy holiday dead bodies to be hanging there, because it took a while to die via crucifixion. When I was a kid, I didn't know exactly how nails in my hand, or nails in someone's hands and feet would kill them. Like, I'm just gonna hang there with nails in my hands and feet. It's gonna hurt, but like, do I eventually bleed out from my hands and feet? Like, how does that actually work? Well, we kind of get a glimpse of that, because they wanted to speed this up so that they could get it out of their way, the religious leaders, and they said, hey, let's break the legs. Well, how would breaking legs kill somebody? See, at the early part of crucifixion, there's this little platform that those who were crucified would be able to put their feet on, and they'd be able to push up with their arms and their legs and be able to take a breath. I mean, in Jesus' case, beaten and bloodied, but yet able to struggle for some breath. Eventually, to speed up the process, they break legs. And guess what happens when you break legs? You can't push up. You have to just use your arms, and eventually your arms are going to wear out, and you suffocate. When I was a kid, I was thinking, like, how did Jesus die with hands and feet? No, he suffocated. Well, actually, Jesus died before that point. They didn't have to break his legs, right? But that's how people died on the cross. They would eventually suffocate. When they get to Jesus, they notice that he's already dead. But what's interesting about this is, here, before we get any further with Jesus, why would John wait till this point in the story to say it was the day of preparation? Wasn't it the day of preparation just a few hours before when they crucified? I'm like, well, couldn't he have given us the setting earlier in the story? But he waits to this point, A, to explain why the religious leaders wanted his legs broken. But I also believe the day of preparation shows us something about Jesus. Because the day of preparation before the Passover that happens, the day before the Sabbath on the Passover, is the day that they slaughter the lamb for the celebration of the Passover. Jesus is the fulfillment of the Passover lamb. Jesus slaughtered on the same day the lambs were slaughtered, is what I'm saying. So they get to Jesus, and they break the legs of the two crucified men next to him. They get to Jesus, and he's already dead. Remember, he was beaten. He was beaten so bad he couldn't even carry his own cross all the way. And it says water and blood poured out. Now, what's that about? If he was just alive, it would just be water. But he had both of these. Now, what's funny is at this point in the sermon, there's a temptation for a preacher like me to try to give you the medical explanation. But I'll be honest with you, I will be outside of my lane on that one. So I did a quick search, and you can do the same thing. And it came up with words, speaking about stay in your lane, Jerome, hypovolemic shock, which would come as a result of his being beaten so severely, which would lead to pericardial infusion. Some of you know what I'm talking about, but most of us don't. Which is the fluid that builds around the heart, and then there's pleural infusion, which is the fluid that surrounds the lungs. So when they spear him through the side and they pierce his chest cavity and the lungs and the heart, that's where water and blood comes out. John's not making a point medically. John's making a really simple point, but yet a really profound point. It's a really simple point. Jesus is dead. It's incredibly profound because he says it back in the very beginning of John chapter 1, verse 14. And then the word became flesh. Flesh that could bleed and flesh that could die. Jesus is dead, which is an important setup for what's going to come next, the resurrection. Jesus is dead, which is an important thing to note for those who would question whether or not he was really dead so that he could question the resurrection. And then John backs this up. John's saying, Jesus is really dead. I know because I was there. Listen to this verse in 35. This report is from an eyewitness giving an accurate account. I don't know what it is with John. He's like Mr. T. Like, pity the fool. No, that's not Mr. T. John never refers to himself, right? He's been the beloved disciple, the disciple that Jesus loves. And he's doing the same thing here. This comes from an eyewitness. He's talking about himself. He speaks the truth so that you can believe. It's consistent with his purpose in writing. It's consistent with how he handles himself in the story of the gospel. He's saying, I was there. I know. I saw this. Most scholars would say John was the only disciple who was there. And I think we see that the disciples were not in the picture. He was there comforting Jesus' mother. And then in verse 36 and 35 and 36 and 37, we see John say the unbroken legs and the spearing of the side, that was all kind of spoken about in the Old Testament. Jesus is the fulfillment of that. Kind of like John was saying, hey, even in death, even on the cross, just like Jesus' life and ministry was fulfillment of Scripture, and so is Jesus' death. Fulfillment of Scripture. Now we get to the next scene of our text, which is the actual burial. Joseph of Arimathea was a secret disciple because he was scared of the Jewish leaders, the religious leaders. Matthew tells us about, you know, Joseph shows up in all the four Gospels. In Matthew, we find out that he's a rich man. In Mark, we find out that he's a member of the High Council, also known as the Sanhedrin. And along with him was a guy named Nicodemus, who's only mentioned in the book of John, but he's kind of famous. Like, he's more famous than Joseph, I would argue. Because Jesus' interaction with Nicodemus gives us some of our most beloved and cherished Scripture. So we first are introduced to Nicodemus in John chapter 3. He comes under the cover of darkness because Nicodemus himself was a Pharisee, a member of the Sanhedrin. He comes to Jesus and they have this interaction. Listen to some of the things that come, the richness that come out of this first interaction. John 3:3. I tell you the truth, this is the words of Jesus. Unless you are born again, you cannot see the kingdom of God. John 3:16. Do I need to read it to you? For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that anyone who believes in him will not perish and have eternal life. Nicodemus comes under cover of darkness because he too is not wanting to be seen. He's coming under cover of night. We see Nicodemus again in John chapter 7 when he stands up to his fellow Jewish religious leaders and says, hey, we should at least give this guy a hearing. And a Jewish law says he should at least get a trial before we convict him and come to a conclusion on him. They kind of are like, are you one of them? To him, and we don't know exactly, is Nicodemus one of them? Is he a follower of Jesus? Now, let me say something really quick, because it's really not a big point, but the scripture says that there was 75 pounds of spices for burial. That's a number that's equivalent to what kings received at that time. Nicodemus is bringing that. I don't imagine him carrying 75 pounds. He's a man of wealth and influence. Probably had servants come with him that did all that work, but Nicodemus is bringing the things that are meant for a king's burial. See, one of the things that John does all through Scripture is he kind of contrasts. Remember Peter was denying Jesus? He stood by the fire. It was cold. And that speaks to something. Well, we see that kind of here too. Nicodemus comes in John chapter 3 under cover of night. But in John chapter 19, he's coming into the light. Listen to what Jesus says. The very last thing he says to Nicodemus in John chapter 3, 21, in their first interaction. But those who do what is right come to the light so others can see what they are doing, that they are doing what God wants. So here Nicodemus is literally coming into the light. His story doesn't end in John chapter 3 in the dark. It ends in the light, in full view of the religious officials and the Roman officials. Joseph of Arimathea, who was a secret disciple, is no longer a secret disciple. They're taking on the task of burying Jesus. And this, contrasted with the disciples' response, who we don't see, the disciples, instead of coming into the light, went into hiding. As I mentioned earlier, John was likely the only disciple present at the crucifixion. In John chapter 20, we find out they were scared. They were hiding in the upper room. The disciples, scared, hiding, lost hope. I don't think they were expecting resurrection. They thought, maybe we've believed in a lie. What do we do now? What a waste of 3 years. How could this possibly happen to the one that we were so convinced was the Messiah? I would even submit that Nicodemus, who was a Pharisee, who believed in a bodily resurrection, unlike the Sadducees, I almost believe like Nicodemus had more faith that Jesus would resurrect, at least eventually, than Jesus' own disciples. But I believe with John standing there by himself, comforting Jesus' mother, the only disciple, John watched this, which we just read, and he saw a glimmer of hope. A glimmer of hope in the darkest moment of his life. A glimmer of hope in the darkest moment of the lives of the disciples. What is that glimmer of hope? Verse 36. They did not break his legs. And you're going, well, why is that a glimmer of hope? Let's talk about that. He says that not breaking his legs was a fulfillment of Scripture. Now, there is no specific Scripture that says, and the Messiah will be crucified, they won't break his legs. There's no, but what we have a lot of times is Old Testament prophecy, especially pointing to the Messiah that we call typological. This is like that. And so you read in God's instructions in Exodus and in Numbers to his people saying, when you celebrate the Passover, which is the celebration of the, you remember the 10 plagues, there was a final one, the Passover, if you're familiar with the Passover in Moses and Egypt. When you celebrate that, you're going to slaughter the lamb, but don't break its bones. Then there's another reference to non-broken bones that people see the Christ in. I mean, it's speaking of a righteous man, but it's speaking of the righteous man who is Jesus. Psalm 34, and actually we're going to share Psalm 34 up here in a second. I'm going to read it to you. The righteous person faces many troubles, but the Lord comes and rescues each time. For the Lord protects the bones of the righteous. Not one of them is broken. You see, as modern readers, I don't think we really get this whole thing about unbroken bones, because quite honestly, broken bones aren't that big of a deal, right? My son broke his pinky finger last year. He got a cast, and now it's like he never broke his bone, except for his pinky is just a little smaller than the other one. Like, it's no big deal in our world we live in. We get a broken bone, we fix it. But in that time, in that place, broken bones cripple you. It's a different world. So the ancients, in that time, in that place, in the ancient world, there was a symbolic significance that's really lost on us. One of the quotes I came across when I was studying said, in the Bible, bones are filled with the marrow of figurative meaning. I love that, marrow, figurative meaning. Let's go back to Exodus and Numbers when God tells his people, don't break the bones of the lamb that you slaughter. Like, does that do the lamb any good? It's already dead. Who cares if we break its bones? And you're thinking, well, that's because he wanted to flex and say, look, Jesus didn't break his bones, boom, I'm flex. No, I mean, there is something there. It's pointing to Jesus for sure, but there's something about bones in Scripture. Let me ask you, and I'll receive a response. What's the most famous bones in the Bible? This is not a trick question. What's that? Ezekiel? Ezekiel, the Valley of Dry Bones, Ezekiel 37? Absolutely. Probably the most famous, but there's one that probably shows up more often. Multiple books. Pretty famous as well. Anyone else? Joseph's. Let's talk about the Bible and how it views bones, right? So Joseph's bones. The very end of the book of Genesis. Now, Joseph, remember, he was sold into slavery. He becomes the number two man in all the land. And he says this upon his death in Genesis chapter 50, verse 25. Let me read it to you. Then Joseph made the sons of Israel swear an oath. And he said, when God comes to help you and lead you back, you must take the bones with you. He's saying, God has promised. This is not it. We have a promised return or restoration to a land that he's promised us, and I'm believing that promise. And you know what? When I die, set my bones aside. Because eventually you're going to carry him out. Now, when Joseph was the number two guy, the children of Israel were in an okay place with him in leadership, but now he's dead. And eventually when we close out Genesis, we open up Exodus, guess what? They're slaves. So that whole time it's their situation has become worse, and now they're slaves. Joseph's bones are there to offer hope of God's promise. And then Moses in Exodus chapter 13 leads the children of Israel out, the slaves out into the wilderness on the way to the promised land, ended up spending 40 years, wasn't exactly the original plan, but 40 years as nomads. Joseph's bones are offering hope of God's promise. And then Joshua takes over, enters into the promised land, begins to take the cities of the promised land. It's not like the people in the promised land were like, oh, welcome. They began to move through. And eventually, Joshua chapter 24, the bones of Joseph, which the Israelites had brought out with them when they left Egypt, were buried. Joshua chapter 24. Because while they're taking the promised land and they're marching around Jericho, Joseph's bones are giving them hope. There's hope in the bones of Joseph. The hope that God will fulfill his promise. Then you get to the New Testament, you hear about Joseph's bones again. The author of Hebrews says that his concern for his bones was a great act of faith. Joseph had faith that God would fulfill his promise, that God would deliver. Joseph's bones represent hope. Now Ezekiel chapter 37. Ezekiel has a vision of a valley of dry bones. The bones represented the lifelessness of God's people. They were lifeless, but they were not yet totally devastated. Not all is lost. Something remains, even if it's just bones. And guess what God does to the bones? He says, Ezekiel, prophesy, and Ezekiel prophesies, and flesh goes. God puts the bones back together. He breathes life into restored bodies, and an army of God's people rises up from the dead. This is the vision that Ezekiel had. The dry bones in this vision represented hope for God's people. See, intact bones, kept bones, unbroken bones, they all represent the hope of restoration, the hope of rescue, the hope of resurrection. There's a hope that God will reassemble the bones, restore the flesh, give life, give breath, and bring the bones back to life. Let's go back to that Psalm chapter 34. The righteous person faces many troubles, but the Lord comes to the rescue each time. See, the promise that is given of the Lord coming to rescue is fueled by the hope of verse 20. For the Lord protects the bones of the righteous. Let me say this. The promise of resurrection is not a promise that there will be no death. Actually, resurrection requires death. You must first die to be brought back to life. Can I just say, in my own life, some of the greatest moments where I've seen God do the most incredible things have come as a result of a death. Not necessarily a death of a person, but a death of a dream, a death of my plans, a death of my will, the death of my kingdom come. It had to die, and it's painful, and it hurts. And God brings about something beautiful, a resurrection from death. See, Psalm 34 does not promise that the righteous man will not suffer. It actually says there will be troubles, even to the point of death. But there's a promised rescue, a restoration, a resurrection. It's exactly this picture that we have of Jesus when we gather next week for Easter. God instructed the righteous man will be resurrected. God instructs his people not to break the lamb's bones because he would raise the true Passover lamb back to life. Now let's go back to that text. Back to the crucifixion. Back to John watching them not break the bones of Jesus. In the darkest moment of John's life, he sees a glimmer of hope. The lifeless body of Jesus is nailed to the cross. But yet God's keeping hope alive in unbroken bones. Church, can I say the darkest moments of your life, in the darkest moments of your life, whether you see it at the moment or not, God is keeping hope alive. Jesus' broken legs point to the hope of resurrection. Jesus' unbroken legs point to the hope of resurrection. Jesus' unbroken legs are an invitation to his disciples to hope, even as they wipe the tears from their eyes. And just like it is for them in the darkest moments of your life, whether you see it at that moment or not, God is keeping hope alive. So if that's true, then what do we do about it? Let me give you a couple things. First of all, in the dark moments of your life, keep your eyes open. See, all of Jesus' disciples went into hiding except for John. Fear, anger, denial, hopelessness, doubts, and questions. We do the same thing. John, however, did not retreat, and because he did not retreat, he saw hope. He saw a glimpse of hope. He saw the unbroken bones of Jesus. You can't see a glimmer of hope in the darkness unless you're willing to peer into the darkness. We don't like to peer into the darkness. We want to retreat, find a distraction, and we live in a world with many, many distractions. So we don't have to deal with the dark moments, with the pain, the unknown. How do you keep your eyes open? Let me tell you, you know the promises, just like Joseph. You know the character, just like the psalmist of God. How do you keep your eyes open in the darkness? How do you keep your eyes open in the dark moments of your life? You know the promises and the characters of God. See, John's story, he sees a glimpse of hope, literally, in the situation. We don't always get that. Sometimes we do. But sometimes the glimpse of hope is something that we bring with us, something that's been deposited in us. See, when we're looking for a glimmer of hope, we're actually looking for something to say. We're not looking for a glimmer, let's be honest. We want God to provide like a big neon sign that says, everything's going to be okay. How many of you know that we don't get that? Well, sometimes, but usually not. Not as much as we want it. How about that? Sometimes the glimmer of hope is something deposited in you. When you peer into the dark moments and you find hope because you know the promises and the character of God. You know the God of the universe. We say that casually, but that's mind-blowing. You find hope, a glimmer of hope, because you've experienced God's faithfulness in the past and you're confident that he'll be faithful today. He is the God who looked at Joshua, and I know this is a promise to Joshua, but it's the same God who says, be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid or discouraged. For the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. He's the God who said to his people through the prophet Isaiah, don't be afraid, for I am with you. Don't be discouraged, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will hold you up with my victorious right hand. He's the God who says to his people through Moses, so be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid and do not panic before them. For the Lord your God will personally go ahead of you. He will neither fail you nor abandon you. He's the same God who said to his disciples, both then and now, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. He's the same God who says to his church through the Apostle Paul, I'm convinced that nothing can ever separate us from God's love, neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither our fears for today nor our worries about tomorrow. Not even the powers of hell can separate us from God's love. No power in the sky above or in the earth below. Indeed, nothing in all creation will ever be able to separate us from the love of God that is revealed in Jesus Christ our Lord. Keep your eyes open, peer into darkness. Find the glimmer. Very likely it's been something that you hold with you already. If you know the word, you know the one who gave us the word. Second thing is this. Look to Jesus' unbroken bones. See, God kept Jesus' bones. They were not broken. Seems like a random coincidence. Oh, I guess this guy's dead already. God keeps his bones and he raises him to life, and he'll do the same with yours if you are in Christ. Look to Jesus' bones, his unbroken bones. As a Christian, you've already been raised to new life. The Apostle Paul says this in Ephesians, but God is so rich in mercy that he loved us so much that even though we were dead because of our sins, he gave us life. When he raised us, he raised Christ from the dead. He raised us with him. You've already experienced a spiritual resurrection, and we await a bodily resurrection to come. And if we look to his bones in our darkest moments, if we could do that with a deep confidence that there is a rescue to come that's far more glorious than anything we face in the moment. Overwhelming victory is ours, is what Paul says. If we look to his bones and know that there is a victory to come because of his unbroken bones, maybe we could share in Paul's endurance when he writes this: For our present troubles are small and won't last very long. My present troubles seem to be pretty big and seem like they take forever. But from Paul's perspective, looking at the unbroken bones of Jesus, they're small and won't last very long. And yet they produce for us a glory that vastly outweighs them and will last forever. So don't look at the troubles that we can see now. Rather, we fix our gaze on the things that cannot be seen. For the things that we see now will soon be gone. The things we cannot see will last forever. If you are a Christian, look to the unbroken bones of Jesus. If you're not a Christian, we're delighted that you're here. It's a great day to be in church. It's Palm Sunday. By the way, isn't that awesome? That's so cool. Thank you. Yeah. I know, that's like totally random deviating, but I meant to do that earlier. Thank you to Chris Hanneman and Kelly Spohr for, wait till you see what's coming for next Sunday. Oh, anyway, be here, that's what I'm saying. Let me close on this. And the band could come at this time, actually. Because I want to close with the words that we sang a little less than an hour ago. Because this is where we're leaving off in this story. This is the setup to the resurrection. But it's words that look at the unbroken bones of Jesus. Listen to the words that we sang and that we'll sing in a moment. I cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone, Messiah still and all alone. Would you pray with me? Father, as we prepare our hearts, this journey of preparing our hearts for that glorious day, that Resurrection Sunday, where we look at the text that we'll look at next week, that death did not hold you. Father, I pray that you would indeed prepare our hearts this week, that even if we're walking in a moment that seems like a dark moment, in a season that seems to be celebratory and it's sunny outside mostly, and we can be living in a dark moment. God, may you allow for us to peer into darkness to look for that glimmer of hope. May you allow for us not to just do that, but to look at the unbroken bones of your Son, Jesus Christ, knowing that what we face today is nothing compared to what's to come. We love you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.